Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
Welcome to Annette on America. This is Annette Bybee, your host. I am a recovering lawyer, a mom, a single mom to two teens and a tween. And we are now fully into summertime. So I am relieved of my teaching duties for now, but I have kids at home full time. And so it's kind of trading six of one for half a dozen of the other. But today they're not here. So I'm trying to relax. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to bring in a fun guest that I've had on before. And we're going to have more time this time to get into some detail on some of these topics that we didn't have time to talk about last time. And if you haven't checked out my show before, you can go find all of my old episodes on YouTube. Just type in Annette Talks or to any of the podcast providers. I'm all over the place, so you can find me somewhere. Also, feel free to follow me on Facebook. Just look for Annette Bybee, B-Y-B-E-E. And follow me on Facebook. All right. So today I have brought back Cain, the man with the one name, one word name. And Cain, you were on before, and I forgot to ask you before, like where you got your name from, because I know that's not your legal name, but I'm curious to know at some point where that came from. And then you can tell us about your organization, Taskforcefreedom, and how that all got rolling.
You got it. Well, I can call you Bybee. Is that okay?
Sure. You're okay. The only one, and that's cool. You're Cain.
Okay. Well, Cain, well, first of all, we're with Taskforcefreedom, and we're fighting the teaching of critical race theory, social emotional learning, the whole sexual grooming of our kids. The name Cain, I don't really go by my government name. And so Cain, I got from, there's an old TV show called Kung Fu. Uh-huh. And the character is he's a white character, but he was raised in China. And he learned to be, I don't know, like a 10th degree karate expert or something. Uh-huh. But he's very calm and peaceful. However, he's okay with using his skills to defend the innocent. And so I'm calm, peaceful. I'm pretty loud sometimes, but I think we as men are supposed to protect the innocent, our wives, our children, and our country. So awesome. That's where Cain comes from.
I remember that show. I remember it was when you can take the pebbles from my hand. Right?
Grasshopper. Yes.
I remember being a kid and watching that show. I could totally picture it.
I love that show. And he never picked a fight, but he always ended it. And so, and my personality is somewhat like that. But so I'm a father of three. I have three daughters. They're all grown. I have a stepson and a stepdaughter, and they're all grown. And then I have two grandbabies, and that's 6 and 11. And then I have two godbabies the same age.
So the 6 and 11-year-old are in school, obviously.
Yes. Yes. Background in the military and law enforcement. I've been the owner operator of three restaurants and a catering business. And I currently have my own home-based business as well as working in oil and gas.
So you're a little busy.
I'm a little busy and I don't really have free time because I do Taskforcefreedom.
So to add Taskforcefreedom, it sounds like you're starting to make some or gain some traction from what I'm seeing on Facebook. I saw that you were going to put up a website. Has that happened yet?
So we're working on the website now. I tried to do it myself. it was a disaster. So I met with a gentleman on last Friday who was going to set everything up for us. And then Susan, our coordinator, is actually going to build it. So it might take a few weeks before we're up and running.
What will the URL be when it's done? Is it taskforcefreedom.com or .org?
Yeah, probably taskforcefreedom.com if it's available.
Okay.
And then we have someone working on a logo. So nice. Things are happening. I will say this. I have to acknowledge, number one, my wife, who puts up with me and all the craziness that I'm involved with. And And then our team, we have amazing, absolutely amazing volunteers and coordinators. There's no way I can do all the things that's going on right now. We have so many different team members working on different areas where we can protect our kids. And most people in the public, they have no idea that these moms, these dads, these grandmas are spending their own time protecting our kids, gathering information, running recon. Like, we have some absolute studs that are working really hard. So
awesome. Cain, I don't know if you saw on Facebook, but since we last talked, I actually had a discussion with the principal at the middle school over here that my girls were in last year before I yanked them, because the yearbook came out, and it right in the middle, it had a 2-page spread teaching, educating everyone all about the LGBTQ, TIA, 2+, whatever, QWERTY. My friend, my computer nerd friend says QWERTY. Flags, all the flags, right? And I mean, it was like, you know, what's pansexual mean, and what's bisexual, and what's gay, MLM, and like the whole thing, 2-page, yeah, right? And I just about fell out of my chair when I saw it. And so I had a conversation with the principal about that. Of course, she stuck to her guns on that. They're just trying to protect the students that are going to be bullied or are being bullied, that are gay or identify some way. And she stuck to her guns. I have to admire her. She at least took my phone call and talked to me about it. But right. I said, I want you to know why students are leaving. So when you're wondering why students are leaving, now you'll know one of the reasons why students are leaving, because that middle school has gone from like 900 to 600 over the last few years.
Yes. And it's going to get worse, because we're still under a campaign to boycott the government schools.
Yep.
There is nothing safe. There's nothing that's educational in these schools. They're not, people seem to think that they're making poor decisions and they're not well informed. Nope, they're corrupt. They're corrupt from the top down to the dirt in the parking lot. They cannot be fixed. It's pure evil. So here's the thing. Democrats, which I think they're no longer Democrats, I think they're Marxists. 100% Marxists. They hate our country. They hate us as Americans who believe in the country, and they want us to be a communist nation like Venezuela or Cuba. And so it's difficult to even talk with these administrators when they are, they have an agenda that they have to attain. And so you're having these conversations hoping for, some compassion and understanding, and they'll shake their head and smile and go, well, you know, we have to recognize and acknowledge those who are being mistreated. Well, since when did less than 1% of the population get more benefits, more equality, more equity, as they would put, over the other 99%? This is what the Democrats do. In order for their strategy to work, they need victims.
Yes.
So they victimize the Black community, if that's really a thing, and they've taken the gay and lesbian plus. I don't do the LGBTQ thing. That's their terminology. Those are their phrases. I just go, I know gays, I know lesbians, and if there's other stuff after that, it's a plus. Yeah. So the gay
and that's not really the community that they want us to think it is either, because when I talk to gay people, they tell me that they're not really, they don't really feel like they relate to transgender individuals. And so we are being told to see them as a sort of monolithic community, but they really aren't. But what's gone on is that you're talking about them being Marxists. That's underlying it. But I think a lot of the administrators, like this lady I talked to, I respect her as a woman, as a person, but she's a useful idiot when it comes to this kind of thing. I don't think most of them are doing this with a Marxist agenda in mind, but the fact that they go along with it and they buy into it and they don't think critically about the whole thing and go further with their thought process says that they're useful idiots, because it's not a monolithic community. And they don't realize that when they put this you know, in my middle school where my girls were at, they have all the rainbow flags or the rainbow stickers, ally stickers everywhere. And it makes for an atmosphere that's frankly creepy and not comfortable for those that don't relate to that community. And it makes me as a 53-year-old woman walking through the hallway makes me feel, well, oogie. I don't know how else to put it, but
yes,
but it's
yes.
Like, what are you guys trying to promote here? This is not just trying to make people feel safe. This is saying, hey, gay is cool. Anything but straight is cool. And if you're going to come to us and tell us that you're anything but straight, we will be your ally. We are all for that, right? That's what it felt like to me.
So I am hard on teachers. I'm hard on administrators. We do have an association with a young lady named Christina Galloway, and she has a teacher support group. And we support her, and we want to be able to help the teachers. However, if you know the kids are being harmed by this gay and lesbian plus issue, why are you still allowing it in your school when you know it's harming them? And so when I say Marxist mentality, if you don't speak out against it, then you have to be for it. I don't know what the reasons are. If it's financial, shame on you. Mm-hmm. They are hurting kids that will be harmed for the rest of their lives. If they don't stop it now, the parents are going to have to deal with that problem when that kid turns 18 and they're going to spend the next 10 years in a psychiatrist or psychologist's office trying to correct the damage that the schools have done. During the Nazi camps, these guards, they would go home at night.
Right.
They'd go home, they'd play kickball with their kids, they'd pet the dog, the wife would feed them. The wife knew what was going on. That doesn't make it okay. Mm-hmm. That doesn't make it okay that the wife, or should I say even the Catholic Church, who knew what was going on, and they accepted it. It's still wrong. It's still 100% wrong for an administrator to force this mess onto kids. I heard a couple of statistics. One, that it's less than 1% of the population, the gay and lesbian plus. So why is it now that in high school, 20% of young girls think they're lesbian?
Yeah.
What? Why? How did that happen? It happened because a bunch of knuckleheads in our schools are indoctrinating these young kids with heads full of mush.
Yeah.
It's horrid what they're doing. And so my mom's a Democrat. My mother-in-law's a Democrat. And as far as I'm concerned, they are Marxist supporters. And they need these victims so that they can maintain their control. What they're doing with the gay and lesbians is exactly what they've done with Black people for decades and decades.
Well, Cain,
make them a victim.
Sorry, I have to stop you for a second. Just because the reason I wanted to make this point, I made the same point, I think, when I was on Kim Munson's show the other day. One of the reasons why these young 12, 13-year-olds and high school students and college students are so on board, and I would say a lot of members of various churches, I see some of the members of my church doing the same thing. One of the reasons, I would say probably the main reason so many of them are on board with it is because they see this as a civil rights fight of their time, right? Just, you know, yeah. Like in the 60s, when white people would get together with Black folk and walk with them and march with them, that was their thing. And so that was their cause. And that was a righteous cause. But now you have this totally, totally different situation.
They have completely taken the gay and lesbian plus community and painted that picture like they have been so discriminated against. I don't know of gays and lesbians that went through slavery for 400 years. But they've placed them in the same category as Blacks. And all it's done was to make them victims so that they can maintain their power and control. It's sickening. And society in a whole is going to have to deal with this in the future. Mm-hmm.
I have to say real quick, I would love to be at your Thanksgiving table when you and your parents.
You're
a very conservative Black man, and your family is, your members are, you call them Marxists.
They are Marxist Democrats.
Gotta be interesting.
They are. And so we don't really talk. This is what I do. I don't bring it up. And they know not to bring it up with me.
Yeah. Well, that's good. That's good. You've all kind of made that agreement, because otherwise.
Well, if they open the door, I promise you, I'm stepping in with both feet. And then they're going to go, okay, here's the crazy uncle again. And it's fine. But, and that's their, they have that right. Like, I would die for them to have that right to make their own choices. Mm-hmm. Their choices are completely wrong.
That means I have to ask you another question too, because, on my last show, and I can see it on the bottom of your Zoom screen, it says a proud American Negro. And you,
yes, ma'am.
And so I just think it's so fun that you you call yourself a Negro. White folks, we can't get away with saying that. But I want to know if your family, the Marxists, what they think about that, and if they insist on being called people of color or African American, or how that goes down.
Honestly, I think I may be the only person in the country that outwardly says I'm a Negro. I don't know of anyone else that's saying that. Now, here, this is why I'm a Negro. Martin Luther King said I was a Negro in just about every speech that he's given. Frederick Douglass, every book that he has, every speech he's given, he refers to us as Negro. Somewhere, somehow, 30, 40, 50 years ago, they decided we're gonna make Negro a bad word. I don't know why. I suspect that they did it to maintain that cloud between Negroes and Caucasians. Mm-hmm. Because if you could never identify or talk to me about who I am or what I am, you're always on your heels. Like even now, mm-hmm. I bet you don't know when you see a Black person, should I call him Black? Is he African, African American?
Is he a person of color right now? Isn't the latest person of color? I mean, isn't that what
person of color or colored? I mean, the NAACP is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People.
Yeah, and that
can you say colored?
Yeah, colored is supposed to be a bad word now too, right? But it's confusing because now it's people of color. So wait a minute, are we coming back full circle?
Yeah, but here's the thing. So people of color. So being a Negro just simply says, first and foremost, I'm American. First and before I'm anything else, our people have been here for 400 years, which is longer than most cultures in this country. Mm-hmm. Secondly, my skin is brown. It's melanated, which makes me a Negro. It's Portuguese for Black.
Right.
Okay. Right. A lot of folks identify as African or African American. And they say, well, we're not going to use Negro because, you know, it's tied to slavery. Mm-hmm. You know, the slave masters called them niggers.
Yeah. Well, I hope that one gets by. I hope.
You have to edit that one out. No, I'm sorry.
Just wondering, folks, if there's a bleep like a minute ago, it's because Cain, who calls himself a proud American Negro, used the N-word that we're all not supposed to use ever, ever, ever.
Yes, I did because, well, let me finish this about, and we're going to talk about that N-word thing. Okay. So let me finish this about African. If Negroes are upset at the word Negro because it's tied to slavery, then why do they identify with Africa?
Right.
Why would you say African-American? Because it was African tribes that stole your people from that land and sold you to the slave ship. So why in the world would you identify with a country, a continent that enslaved you and sold you to Spaniards?
Right.
I choose Negro because there's nothing wrong with it. Who said it was wrong? I want to know the person that says saying Negro was wrong. Now I'm going to say another word. You probably have to beep it. Another word, which is very common in the Black community, if there's really a thing, right, is nigga.
Oh, right, right.
Okay. Nigga is a slang term for Negro. Mm-hmm. See, I'm offended that we as Black people are okay with white people censoring their own speech. You have a First Amendment right to say any word that you want to say. Any word. If white people decided that black people can no longer say mom or big mama. We're going to remove that from your vocabulary. You're going to take it out of your dictionary. You can no longer say those two words. The whole country would come apart. There's no way you're going to be able to tell black people, like back in the 60s, that you can't go into this bathroom or you can't drink from this faucet. What's the difference if there were, back in the day, there were black only bathrooms and black only faucets, and today there's black only words. I mean, should I say white only bathrooms and white only faucets?
Well, and you know what, that brings up another point. We're seeing, you know, purposeful segregation on campuses by black folks. And oh gosh, where was it? There was a school, it was here in Colorado, that had, it was one, it was on their sign and it said, what was it? Was it people?
It was down in the Denver area, yeah. And they were having a play night out or something, and right. It was for black only.
Yeah, and I thought, whoa, why is that okay anytime?
So the Marxists, Democrats, they want segregation. So if you don't teach children the greatness of this country, black or white, it's easy for a black child or black people to say, hey, we're going to give you your own night and white people can't show up. And then in turn, white people are like, well, okay, we don't need you anyway. We don't want, they don't want us together. Mm-hmm. They want us divided. And it's sickening that black adults are okay with this. Martin Luther King died for this, for equal treatment under the law, for equal opportunities. And we have so-called black leaders saying, no, we're going to have our own little thing. I said, okay, if you want to do that, man, there's a bunch of black people in Africa. There's a whole bunch. You will never, in fact, there's parts of Africa you would never see white people. It's disgusting what they're doing. They're teaching hatred. They're teaching bigotry to whites and blacks. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're telling little white kids that black people aren't that smart. Like they need extra help because, you know, they have brown skin. And then you're telling black kids, white kids are oppressors. The reason why you can't make it is because little white Johnny over there. These are evil people. I have no sympathy. I have no kind words for evil Marxist cockroaches. What they are doing, they are trying to destroy the future of our country by harming these kids. And these kids are going to have to live with this for a long time. I mean, I have so many stories about, you know, little white kids who can't play with their black friends anymore. Best friends, and they've created this fog, this division between them, and now that it's hard for them to even have a conversation.
Yeah, you know, I read this, it was a Dinesh D'Souza book, and by the time this airs, I should have already had Dinesh D'Souza on again to talk about 2,000 Mules. And it was, I think it was United States of Socialism was the book. And he talks about how one of the reasons why we are seeing all the LGBTQ, TIA, plus, minus, subtraction, you know, I mean, whatever it is today. The reason we're seeing that as a new group of victims is because in socialists, like in Venezuela, they get the victims and they group them all together. Right. So you have blacks, gays, Asians are never part of that. Notice that.
No, they have their different factions. But listen, you can see what Biden has tried to do. He signed in January an Asian Protection Act because there was a shooting last year. And I think four or six Asians were killed. Yeah. And he comes up with this Asian Protection Act.
Oh, I didn't.
And I'm like, I'm like, I know what you're doing. You need more victims. Uh-huh. You need to create another class of victims. And the Asians are not going to do it.
No,
they're not going to jump on board.
They like want to study and work hard and get there on their own merits, you know?
Yeah. And this is going off into, this is going in the right field a little bit. But if you look at it, he signed this act back in January. identifying a problem that there should be an act, an Asian Protection Act. How in the world do you identify a problem, come up with an act to protect them, and never talk about who is causing the problem?
Right.
How do you not say who the perpetrators are? Because 90% of the perpetrators are going to be Black. Mm-hmm. It's been that way for decades and decades. But he wouldn't talk about that. Now, here's the other thing. 150 Black people get killed every single week in inner cities. 150 men, women, and children get killed every single week. How about a Negro Protection Act? These people are freaking, excuse my French. You'll bleep that out.
Well, freaking's okay.
These people are evil. They play games with us like we're checkers. We're not even on a chessboard, like we're checkers. And unfortunately, too many people buy into it. And they believe their stuff. These people don't care about me, you, or anything. They care about their power, and they're going to use us like a checkerboard.
Well, I think that's one thing that we're finding out. If a lot of people didn't realize before Build Back Better, which is just a branch off of the Great Reset, which is we're supposed to not own anything and be happy about that. To me, that says they're trying to create a world full of slaves. I mean, other than the top tier, you know, the owners, the corporate owners and politicians, if you don't own anything and then, you know, they take your guns away, what do you got? Nothing.
Yes. And they're...
Before you answer that, we're going to take a real quick break because we're up on halfway there. So we will be right back.
This is KLZ 560, your home station.
The National Crawford Roundtable, better known as NCR, is no longer just an audio podcast, but now can be watched online on demand. So many wonder what our matchless hosts not just look like, but how they communicate, what their body language is like, what their mannerisms are, all normal curiosities. Now you can answer those questions and watch Bob, Neil, Roger, and John on NCR. Go to myhopenow.com, and right there on the homepage will be our beloved foursome for you to enjoy. Along with NCR, you'll also be able to watch select episodes of each host's radio show for the first time. That's myhopenow.com to now hear and see these great opinion leaders. I'm General Manager Don Crawford Jr.
Has your family been thinking about homeschooling? But maybe you're wondering, am I qualified? Can I afford it? What about socialization? For over 30 years, Christian Home Educators of Colorado, or CHEC, has helped tens of thousands of parents to successfully homeschool. Now, they are ready to help you too. When you don't have experience with something, it's hard to know how to begin. One thing that you do know is that you love your children and you want something different than what the public schools have to offer. CHEC exists to defend your family's freedom and help you homeschool with confidence. They encourage questions and have the answers that you are looking for as a first-time homeschooler. Go to ColoradoHomeschool.com and sign up to receive a free new-to-homeschooling starter package. Homeschooling is the best way to prepare your children for a life of service and success. So go to ColoradoHomeschool.com today.
Your home, the safety zone, a place where you rest, invest, gather, grow, watch, and work. On KLZ, we seek to edify you at home with educational and entertaining programming. We handpick advertising partners to protect and improve your home. We serve as a second home where you can join a community of like-minded individuals. We are Crawford Media Group, and you're listening to KLZ 560, your home station.
The following program was recorded at an earlier time.
KLZ 560, Public Affairs.
Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
All right, we are back with Cain, who calls himself a proud American Negro.
And yes, ma'am.
We're kind of ranging all over the place, which is fun.
We are.
Not often that I can do that, but it reminds me of my old podcast days. You know, I'm supposed to be more radio, less podcast, but today it feels very podcasty to me, and I love it. And so we're talking about when we went to break, I opened up a just big old can of worms with the whole ESG, Great Reset, Build Back Better. It's all I've been reading Glenn Beck's Great Reset and watching the gas prices. By the time this airs, I'm guessing everyone's paying over $5 a gallon because we're inching up to it here in Colorado. It's like every day. I've gotten to the point where I want to wear blinders when I'm driving around because I do not want to look at gas station yep. prices because they upset me so much. But we know that that is on purpose, that
yes.
To move to a green economy before we're ready to, and it's part of the Great Reset. And so, it's so aggravating because we know that this is not just like the market or, it's accidental. No. How about some, I could go for some XL Keystone Pipeline right about now, right?
Right. Can I do this before I go back into the next topic?
Yes.
I just want to talk about Task Force Freedom and
mm-hmm.
how we're fighting the CRT, the SEL, the sexual grooming of our kids. We're at Task Force Freedom at AOL. And also if you can reach us on my email address is taskforcefreedom@AOL. Facebook is Task Force Freedom. On Facebook, for the parents.
You're the only person I know that still has an AOL account, by the way.
Well, because I'm a young old dude, and they don't. And because it's an older platform, they don't mess with you too much.
Ah.
Like I don't get a whole lot of garbage from, the interwebs. So, nice. and it still works. So, but I get
Task Force.
I get laughed at.
Yeah, I'm sure you do.
But So a couple things is that we have is we're boycotting the government schools. Mm-hmm. Take your kids out of the schools. It cannot be fixed. We at Task Force Freedom can help you get into homeschooling co-ops. There's several different platforms that we're learning about so we can provide that service or the information for these parents. Take your kids out. You can't fix it. It's completely broken.
Well, it could be fixed, but it's probably not going to be fixed in time for your kids. So, maybe your kids' kids, but we have to get rid of unions first. And that's.
Yes. Yeah. And then one of the other things that we're doing with our organization, we have an amazing coordinator that's handling future seminars. So we're going to be doing other seminars, myself, Aaron Lee, and another, a third speaker, I guess. Here in the future. So we're going to go into different counties and start educating folks on what they can do hands-on to help their students. The biggest thing is, I would say this to you. If it can't be fixed and there's sharks in the pool, would you throw your kids in that pool? You wouldn't.
Right.
Would it be hard to keep your kids at home and not let them go into the pool? Yeah. Would it be some suffering? Some sacrifice that takes place. Yeah. But I guarantee you this, the sacrifice you make today, it's going to save your kid in the future because you keep them in that pool. They're going to get eaten bit by bit. Mm-hmm. And someday you're going to have to patch all of those wounds. And it might take you your entire life savings to fix your child. These people are not playing. Mm-hmm. They want your kids to be a indoctrinated government minion.
Right.
So take them out.
Well, and Cain, what the point that I was making when I was on Kim Munson the other day is that our kids don't know it. When I went into my kids' middle school and saw everything that was going on there, all the signs up and everything, and the way the kids dress too. I don't think the dress code is enforced at all, but they don't know it because I came home and I started talking to them about it and they're like, whatever. It's not a big deal. They are not old enough to understand what's going on and to come home and say, Mom, this is going on. This is not at middle school, not at elementary school, high school. if they've gotten this far in high school, they've probably already been indoctrinated and don't realize it. Yes. I mean, there are some kids that can, you know, are with it enough to realize and want to go against the grain, but that's not the majority. And so
No, it's not.
It's better that we sacrifice now our time, our energy, our money, whatever it is, rather than sacrificing our kids. Because if I left my kids in those schools, I don't know what's going to come out of that. At the very best, probably Democrats, right? That would be terrible.
Yes.
But at the worst, they come out questioning their sexuality, questioning their gender, looking at everyone and categorizing them by race.
Yes.
And that's not what we need. And not learning how to think, right?
Right. Right. So exactly
that's
right.
Why, you know, I put in 2 days a week for like 5 months at a charter school last year to get my kids in. They're all three going in next year. And that school is awesome. For those of us, like I'm a single mom, so I can't homeschool. I can't.
Right.
But I found another alternative. And so I always tell parents, start looking. There are other alternatives.
Start looking. Keep looking. And so sometimes I feel bad because I'm like, dude, I'm saying this really tough thing. Take your kids out. It's just the truth.
Yeah.
It's just the truth. I can't soften that blow. Mm-hmm. I can just tell you, by you allowing your kids to stay in that school, it is harming them. So do it as what you did. It took, like, you worked 2 days a week at another school to take care of your kids.
Mm-hmm.
There's a sacrifice that to be made to make sure your kids are safe. And I'm sorry that it's going to upend your life. But these people are not playing. They want your kids to look at other individuals through the prism of race. And then on top of that, they're telling them, you might be a boy, young man. You might be a girl, young man, or young lady, you might be a boy. That's way too much for a child to have to deal with.
Right.
And that's being told to them by so-called people in charge that they're supposed to look up to learn from. And they're being indoctrinated. And I don't know a softer way to tell folks. I mean, I guess I can take a softer approach, and people can go, well, you know, he's not really that serious. I am dead serious. These people want to harm your child for their benefit. Take them out of the schools.
And not only that, but they're wasting valuable time and resources doing this instead of giving them the education that they actually need. I mean, it's not like our kids are so highly educated that they're like, well, we could cut out some, you know, math and some reading or whatever to do some of this other stuff because, gosh, they're so far ahead, right? Everyone's so far ahead of the curve. No, it's the exact opposite.
No, they're not. In fact, frankly, I told some parents down in Cherry Creek last week, your kids would be better off if they stayed home by themselves and they played video games all day. At least, you know, they're not going to grow up and decide that they want to wear a dress or they hate black people or they hate white people. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe they hate themselves. Maybe because they're white, like, I hate being white. Maybe because they're black, I hate being black. Well, what happens? What do you do when you have people who become these psychotic, I didn't want to say that, but okay. What happens when when their self-image is so bad, where do they turn that energy on?
Right.
What do they turn it to? This is happening today. People, they have more cutters. They have more suicides now than any time ever before here in Colorado.
Well, and they're also teaching them to become activists, right? It's not enough to just hear about things. Now, let's talk about, because we've now touched on the LGBTQTIA plus 22335564. Rush used to say LGBTWTF, and I always thought that was pretty funny.
Right.
But, you know, I hate to make light of it because there are people that are in a situation where they, you know, are uncomfortable, and I feel for them. But, you know, it's funny. I read an article the other day. In my church, we have put out Our prophet has put out a proclamation back in 95 saying that gender was pre-mortal and that we came into the world already having been a male or a female, and that man and woman marry. And, you know, we're 95, we're like, why are they putting this out? Why do we need to know this? Well, now we look back and say, we now know that gender is something that's not, you know, accepted as binary anymore. It's just bizarre.
Right.
But anyway, now I'm starting to lose my, where was I at? So I feel for people who are going through this. And anyway, this article said, what about someone who is attracted to the same sex, but they want to live the gospel? Where do they fit when they see even church members and articles by church members where they've embraced the LGBT movement, the pride movement? Where does someone fit if they're attracted to the same sex, but they don't want to live that lifestyle because they know it goes against God? And I thought that person made a really great point. I feel I did an episode last year in June. I didn't want to do one on pride because I didn't want to even go there. But the Spirit kept telling me, you've got to do this, you've got to do this. So I found a couple of people who were in my church who had same-sex attraction but didn't want to act on it, and they wanted to talk about it. And so that was the most fascinating episode I've ever done. Wow. You can find that on YouTube, Annette Talks. I can't remember what episode number. But it was interesting because the lady, she had lived the lifestyle. She'd lived the gay lifestyle for a long time and come out of it and found Jesus again and was, you know, reading scriptures and on the straight and narrow. And the guy who's never gone off and lived the lifestyle but is same-sex attracted. What was interesting was that they both told me that they think the pride movement is terrible. They don't relate to that at all. I said, so that's like me, only I'm not attracted to the same sex. And they said, yeah, we feel the same way. We're conservative politically. You know, we just happen to be same-sex attracted, but we don't relate to that pride movement. And right. So I feel sorry for people who are either gay and don't relate to that movement, or are same-sex attracted and don't relate to that movement, because they're all put into this category, this monolithic category.
Yes.
And we've seen so much negativity coming out of that pride movement, like, you know, all this grooming and, drag queen shows, which are now, I don't know why and how, I guess it's part of the agenda, but now we have drag queen readings in the library to kids, to little kids. We have over here in my Highlands Ranch Community Association, to one of our rec centers, is going to have drag queen comedy night on Friday for 21 plus. That's great, you know. But why is that necessary to bring into a community center? Why not go have it at a private venue where kids might not be, you know, walking around to the pool or to the gym or whatever?
Yes.
And
if you're an adult and you want to go to a drag queen show, mm-hmm. more power to you. Nobody cares.
Right.
Nobody cares. However, when you're going to a school or you're bringing kids out to a club, 5-6-year-old kids watching drag queen performances. I saw like 4 different videos this week.
From the Aurora.
A little girl putting a dollar in the G-string of a drag queen. This is sick. So here's my question. Where are the fathers? Where are the fathers of these children?
Uh-huh.
Better question. Where are the men?
Yeah, for sure.
That's what I want to know, because we men are failing our children. I know what I would do if I saw my daughter at 6 years old at a drag queen show putting a dollar bill in his G-string. I would shut down that whole place. I'm not a violent person, but we men, we are supposed to protect mm-hmm. our wife, our children, and our country. And men, hear me loud and clear. You are failing.
Mm-hmm.
You are failing your family. There's no way you should be okay with a 6-year-old little girl staring at a man who's dressed like a woman in a G-string.
Yeah. You know what, Cain? I think this is one of the reasons why we're seeing the rise of mama bears right now.
Yep.
And not necessarily because men are failing, but because we just, you know, don't mess with our kids. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can mess with me. You can mess with, you know, I don't know, strangers, but don't mess with my kids. Something else that's interesting that I had a friend tell me that he had stopped being politically active when he did. He and his dad are both statisticians, and they took statistics on the 2020 election and they ran it through some software because he works for a software company I won't mention. And and they both came to the conclusion individually, they didn't know they were both doing this, that this was fraudulent, like it had to have been rigged in some way, right? And so this friend of mine said, you know, I am built to solve problems. I find and I solve problems. When I saw that, I knew there was nothing I could do about it. And I totally felt like my hands were tied and that I was helpless. And so I just decided I was going to step back and step away and not engage politically anymore. And I thought, you know what? I wonder how many men that explains.
I think that is a huge contributor, because especially white men have been demonized for decades and decades. If you speak out against something that's wrong, they're going to call you a racist. White men has been the most feminized gender on the planet, white men. Mm-hmm. They make, if you look at commercials or sitcoms, they're always the buffoon. Mm-hmm. They're always the dumb guy, the weak person. They've done this on purpose. It started all the way back with, you know what, if there's a bully in the playground, you can't fight them back. You have to go get the government worker and they'll take care of it. When I grew up as a kid, the bullies, we met after school. Uh-huh. Heck, sometimes we met at recess. Uh-huh. You didn't go get anybody. You just, you know, put up your knuckles and let's go. They've taken that away from us. They've given it to the government workers, and they never take care of us the way we can take care of ourselves. But I'm saying to the men today, whatever it was that happened to you, you will be held as responsible and accountable for how you protect your own family, for how you protect society, my friends. I've seen these videos with these little babies walking down the runway with drag queens.
Oh, I know.
This is insane. And then you have Marxists that are like, oh, yeah, that's okay. And then you have moms that are bringing them, moms and dads, probably. I didn't see any dads, but these women are saying, no, that's okay. He's going to be a little girl when he grows up. How do you know that? He's 5 years old.
Yeah.
It's pure evil. And the only way you stop them is to remove your kid from that environment. There's no other way to fix this. Yeah. Take your kids out of these government schools, man. Don't let your kids watch these. Okay, I'm going to make a confession.
All right, this is Cain with Task Force Freedom, if you're just tuning in. And he's about to make a confession. All right, Cain, go ahead.
I went to a drag show once. About 20 years ago. I'm going to tell you, it was a blast. It was interesting as heck. A friend of mine talked me into going. And I'm like, I'm not sure I want to do this. Mm-hmm. It was very entertaining. And for adults, it was super cool. They sang. There was a Diana Ross. There was these different characters. And you didn't know they were women. And it wasn't sexualized. They were performers.
Right.
What I see these kids doing, it's a strip club.
Yeah.
It's, you know, vulgar.
Out at the Aurora, I don't know which mall. Did you see the video that was put up? I think Sandy put up, my friend Sandy Garcia on Facebook put up a video from the drag queen show. It was outdoors at a mall in the parking lot. So obviously open to the public.
Yep.
And there's this dude up there wearing next to nothing, doing all these little gymnastic moves.
Gyrations.
Highly sexual. Highly. And you're right. You know, I've seen drag queen movies, right? And they're cute and they're fun. This is a different thing altogether.
It is completely different than what I think Wesley Snipes was in a drag queen movie years ago. Mm-hmm. That's just, those are men dressed like women performing as a woman. It is not a strip club. It is not sexual innuendo. It's just men dressed as women performing.
Right.
I want to know, where are the sheriffs?
Yeah.
Where's the chief of police? Where are the detectives going in going, this is child abuse?
Yeah, well, public.
This is child endangerment.
To do that kind of stuff in public, to out in a mall and a parking lot, how does that get past obscenity laws? You know, I don't know.
It doesn't, but I don't know what's happened with law enforcement. I used to be a police officer too, a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And I don't get it. I just don't understand how someone can even watch these videos and not file a case.
Yeah.
I go, oh, wait a minute. We had a case of child abuse where's social services?
Well, and
it seems like our.
Sorry, why would they need to have them reading books in the library to little kids? How does that have anything to do with, you know, performing songs and things like that? It's obviously just a way to make these kids feel like that's a normal, natural thing.
Yep.
Or a man to dress up as a woman. And by the way, they always go way overboard. I've never worn as much makeup or done as much with my hair. I've worn such high spike heels as men do that. But anyway, why else other than trying to normalize this?
Why is that necessary?
Yeah.
It's not. It has to be their own agenda to destroy these little babies, mm-hmm. to groom them. And so being in law enforcement, I know what happens when young people are sexualized at a very young age. Mm-hmm. They become highly sexual before they're even 18 years old. Mm-hmm. They get into things that their body and their mind is not ready to do, because at 5 or 6 years old, they were introduced to some things that they have no idea what it was.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. What are they reading to these kids? There's a book called The Bluest Eye.
Oh, I saw this portion that you shared on Facebook.
Yes, I'm not even going to talk about it. I'm just going to say it is so vulgar. So, I don't even know the words to say. I was up all night after I read this. Yeah. Page 162 and 163. I'm not going to talk about it because it's so, I can't even talk about it.
What's that by?
In public. Toni Morrison.
Yeah.
She's been writing books forever. Mm-hmm. It is so vulgar, and it's available to 7-year-olds. Mm-hmm. I know here in Larimer County, it's in Thompson School District, it's in Poudre, and it's in D6 in Greeley. Mm-hmm. This one book is so disgusting, and an elementary school kid can co-read it. Mm-hmm. There's another book called Gender Queer. Mm-hmm. It has illustrations in here. That's unbelievable. That a child can go and pick up this thing and see fellatio.
Oh, gosh.
By two men. There's another illustration of clearly is a grown man. He's got facial hair and a beard and everything. And clearly he's caressing kids probably 10 years old, caressing his genitals. Why in the world would a lesbian or a gay person want to be affiliated or associated to this book?
Yeah, you know what?
Why? And so,
the majority of gay individuals do not relate to that and do not think that's okay. You know, yeah. And that's the other problem with this LGBTQ community thing is that people tend to think that they all have the same agenda. And
they do the same thing in the Negro community, that, you know what, we all think the same and we're all Democrats and or we all believe that Black Lives Matter is a real thing. It's not. It's fake, phony Marxist organization. But what needs to happen is people need to be brave and step up and start speaking out. Gays and lesbians, you are being associated with some of the most vulgar, evil writings on the planet. I've seen horrible things as a police officer. It hardly comes close to this book. 2 pages. I didn't read the rest of the book. I read the 2 pages. I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah, it's stuff as an adult, you don't even want to read. It's pornographic.
It's 100% pornographic. And the person, here's the thing. The laws in Colorado are, I can take these books, and if I read it to a child in the parking lot of the library or in the parking lot of the school, I will be committing a second degree misdemeanor, which I can serve a year in prison and a $1,000 fine.
Wow.
If I take the same books and I go into the school or go into the library and read it to a child, it's nothing.
Yeah. Isn't that
something? Means nothing. It's not a violation of anything.
Well, that's, you know, one of the reasons, and we are almost out of time, but the head of the Library Association is an avowed Marxist. I don't know if you know about that.
And
I think she's also a lesbian. So yeah, it's not surprising that this stuff has trickled down into the libraries. So Cain, before we wrap this up, tell me again what your organization's called, how people can get a hold of you.
So Task Force Freedom, you can reach us on email at taskforcefreedom@aol.com. If you're a parent and you need some help, if you're a parent and you want someone to talk with your kids, to tell them the truth, contact us. We're also on Facebook at Task Force Freedom. It's all one word. We will be doing seminars in different counties here in the near future. Boycott the government schools. They can't be saved. I know it's hard, but there's going to be sacrifices that you have to make to save your kids.
And you can help people to get on the road to finding an alternative. Yep.
So we have different teams, different resources to help you walk you through the whole process of starting your own homeschooling, or if you want to do co-op, if you want to do a micro school or something like that. The biggest thing is take your kids out of there.
Yeah.
It can't be fixed. These people, these administrators, they sit there and they pacify you and they talk like they're concerned for you and they're concerned for your kid and they just want to do the right thing. They're full of BS. They don't care. What they care about is their agenda. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe they care more about their paycheck, but someone else is pushing the agenda. You know what I say to them and their paycheck? What are you going to do when all of these kids 5, 10, 15 years from now, when you're retired and you get to see the damage that you caused to these kids?
Yep.
What are you going to do then? You're going to be okay with your pension? Nobody cares about you and your pension when you're hurting little kids.
Right.
So there's a reason why
we are out of time.
we're
going to have, I'm just going to have you on again sometime.
Okay.
So. All right. Well, thanks for coming on, Cain. Listeners, you can email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com. Find me on YouTube, Annette Talks, any of the podcast providers. And I thank you for listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America. And join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all things America.